Hello everyone, and thank you for tuning into Trade Chat. My name is Panzer, and today I'm going to be doing a Q&A video, which I promised like a month ago, but it's happening now, so better late than never, am I right? Yes, I am. Today's video was made ad-free by Loot Crate, so thank you so much to our friends at Loot Crate. If you aren't familiar, Loot Crate is a monthly subscription box. This is Loot Crate DX. It is filled to the brim with geeky and nerdy and gamery type stuff. Every month there is a theme, and all of the contents of the crate goes along with that theme. They have ones for gaming. This is the deluxe version, so it's got all premium items in it, plus their base crate, loot pets, all sorts of stuff. If you're interested, head over to lootcrate.com/tradechat, check it out. We'll talk a little bit more about this specific Loot Crate DX a little later in the video, but thank you again to Loot Crate for making this video ad-free, because you know what? We all hate ads. I know, you're gonna be like, that was an ad. It's not the same thing. I'm not listening to the microphone on your cell phone thinking about your conversations and deciding what kind of ads I'm gonna pop on your screen. I see what you're doing, Google. Anyways, let's get into the questions. So thank you to everybody on Twitter who submitted these questions. I appreciate it and I'm excited to answer them. I picked 20 in total because I haven't done one of these videos in like a year, so I feel like I have a lot of ground to cover. And the first question is from ST Bruni, and it says, when did you decide to dye your hair pink and why did you do it? Was it to make a statement or was it just for fun? Well, I first dyed my hair pink in, I think it was 2011, but it could have been 2012. It was a while ago, 5 or 6 years ago. And you know, you'd think there was some big planning that went into it, but truthfully, my sister and I were at the store and saw pink hair dye, and I was like, oh, we should dye my hair pink. And she was like, yeah, let's do it. And then we dyed my hair pink, and that's all there was to it. There was no big story or some greater reason. I wasn't trying to make a statement. I just saw pink hair dye and was like, whoa, I could have pink hair. And then I had pink hair. And then for a little while, I had blonde hair there in the middle. My sister didn't want me to have pink hair at her wedding because her dresses were like peach, like all the bridesmaid dresses, and it was really clashy, I guess. So I had like a year period there where I had like blonde hair, and that was weird. But I'm back to pink, and it's what I will stay until, I guess, people start telling me I'm inappropriately aged. But no specific statement. It just looked fun, so I did it, and then I really liked it, and it kind of, I think it suits me. The next question is from Bao Animal Lover, and it says, how difficult is it maintaining rainbow colored hair? Very difficult. That's why I've only had it like twice. Rainbow hair is like, you guys have seen it. I did it for BlizzCon, I did it for a couple other things, but I've had like chunks of all different colors. It's awful to maintain. It's terrible. It's the worst. That's why I do it like one time and then go back to a solid color. Two colors isn't bad, but rainbow and stuff is terrible. It all bleeds together. Well, mine actually didn't. I used Pravana No Slip dyes and they didn't actually bleed. They actually faded very nicely to a pastel rainbow, but it still would have been so much work to resection it off the same way. And more power to the girls who do it. That wasn't my life, though. The next question is from Amora Annette, and it says, any upcoming tattoo plans, 5 to 10 year goals, and what is your dream vacation? That's three questions, Annette. As far as tattoo plans, I do plan to sleeve this arm, which I know is like a controversial thing. I don't know why that surprises anybody. I mean, I'm pretty, I don't want to say heavily tattooed, but I have a lot of tattoos, and I've always wanted a sleeve, and it's funny, because I've always wanted a sleeve, and I always thought my sister would be against it, and then one day, she, like, was like, you know, I could see you with a sleeve, like, a really colorful one, done, you shouldn't have said that, now it's happening, so eventually this will be sleeved, and my plan is kind of to just have a scrapbook, if you will, of tattoos. There's nothing wrong with people who do a full piece, and I appreciate the artwork behind that, but I want my tattoos to sell the story of my life, I guess. Like, I feel like I get tattooed at important and pivotal moments in my life, and all of my tattoos are very meaningful to me. Well, okay, not all of them, but most of my tattoos are very meaningful to me, and I've been meaning to do a tattoo update video, but what happened was I have very sensitive skin, so occasionally my tattoos will, like, flare up. And I know that's, like, gross, but it's true. They'll get, like, swollen, and now I feel like I need lotion because I'm talking about this, so. But, ew, that was the grossest noise. Yeah, so sometimes my tattoos will also get, like, you know, reactions to something I touched or a soap that I used. And shortly after I got this new Harry Potter tattoo on my wrist, I don't know what I touched, but the whole thing was just like so inflamed and swollen and itchy. And oh, it looked like I had scabies. And it wasn't the tattoo artist. It wasn't even me. That's happened with a lot of my tattoos. It doesn't matter if they're new or old. This one will raise all up anytime. If I'm outside for any length of time, this one raises. And it just happens. Like, some people are more sensitive than others. I have sensitive skin, and getting tattoos are certain risks that come along with it. So I'm not surprised. But at some point, I will do an update video, because almost every tattoo that you guys can see, like visibly, have some pretty important meaning to them. Obviously, you guys know about my elephant over here, but I like, and my nails are like gross, man. I don't know what I touched, but it was gross. I got like full on distracted by it. Anyways, the next question she asked, so upcoming tattoo plans, so many. And I will do a tattoo update video like this month, okay? Like by the end of February, I'll do a tattoo update video so you can see, you know, nice like pictures or whatever of all my tattoos with little explanations of them. Because the last tattoo video I did, I still had blonde hair and I still was speaking in a very upstate New York accent. So I'm like, I don't know, I just wanted to get a tattoo. So I got a tattoo. It was awful. I don't know why anybody watched my videos. She said 5 to 10 year goals. I have no idea. I am the type of person that my goals are always just to kind of be a better person. I know that's like really cheesy, but I, like financially and stuff, I don't know where I'll be in 5 or 10 years. Like, I don't, if you would ask me 5 years ago if I would even be here right now, I probably would have said no. And if you would ask me 10 years ago, 10 years ago, I would have been 18 years old and I would have been in pre-veterinary school. Like, I was in college for chemistry and biology. I would have had no clue. I didn't even play World of Warcraft 10 years ago. So I played about 9 years ago. I started when I was like 19. So yeah, I have no idea. And I think that's how it's supposed to be. I don't think that you should have these super strict. I mean, it's okay to have an idea of what you want to do or to have goals. But my, like, in terms of an actual like game plan, like, I don't know. I just take life as it happens, and it's a lot to think about, like, and if you get caught up in how the future is going to be, how are you going to be living in the present? So I guess I, in 5 to 10 years, hope to be happier and healthier than I am today. Well, I'm getting over the flu, so I hope I will be healthier tomorrow, but you know what I mean? Like, I hope that I'm taking even better care of myself, and maybe I'll be working out and have some fitness things. Who knows? Like, maybe I'll have, you know, for all the times that I've said, I don't want kids. Who knows? I could have triplets. I mean, you just don't know what the world is going to dish out to you. So my 5 to 10 year goals are to be happy wherever I am in 5 to 10 years. And my dream vacation, I would really love to visit Seoul, South Korea. I would love to go to Australia, although I feel very strongly about some of the bugs that I've seen on the internet that you guys have. So I'm not sure about that. And I would also really love to visit like some, I don't know, like, not necessarily Tokyo, but like Kyoto and stuff like that in Japan that's more like ancient stuff. I love old stuff. So I like going anywhere. Like, that's why I loved going to England, because I love seeing all this architecture from 1,000 years ago and stuff like that. So I would love to go anywhere where I could see things that were very, very old from people who are long gone, because I think that we have a lot to learn. Like, I think that people don't respect history enough, and I think that I feel like anybody who is in government, anybody who's a politician or the president, I feel like they should all have degrees in history. I feel like they all should have extensively studied history, because how can you learn from your mistakes if you don't know what they were? But I don't know. So, question number four is from Cosmic Valkyrie, and it says, what is your favorite thing to do on a rainy day? I live in upstate New York, so a lot of days here are rainy, so I assume that you mean like on a rainy day, you know, like a boring, gloomy, can't do things outside. Although, I never do things outside, let's be honest. But as far as like what I like to do on a day where maybe I don't have plans or my plans fell through, I don't know, man. Like, lately my thing has been just like setting up on my laptop on the couch and just like vegging out and like just kind of like doing something in WoW that's kind of mindless, like archaeology or fishing, and like watching a show and just like full on relaxing. I feel like this year one of my like goals in life was to actually relax more, because I feel like that's something I have to force myself to do. I don't just it doesn't come naturally to me. I'm in, like, my knee-jerk reaction to everything is like, oh, work, I'm like the Energizer Bunny. So I've been really trying to, like, just make an effort to spend more time just relaxing and not working and not looking at social media and just kind of being more, I don't know, present in my own mind. And so I like to, I don't know, you guys know, I like to draw, I like to paint, I like to, when I'm not, you know, like I said, I really like to do those types of things in WoW that are, like, kind of more grindy, like, occasionally on days like that. So, I don't know, just stuff to pass the time. I really like to have something at the end of those days to feel an accomplishment, which is why I tend to like to do archaeology or fishing, because it's like, I spent a whole day getting my artifact fishing, well, 2 or 3 days getting my artifact fishing pole, and I spent all that time getting the mount from archaeology, and sometimes I'll do, like, I'll grind out a rep so that I can get a mount. I like to do things like that on rainy days, because then you feel like you come out of it with something, or, you know, I'll paint or I'll draw, and then I have, like, something to show for my work. So that's what I like to do. The next question is from MickerAllen100, and it says, what would your dream career be if your current career was not an option? This is a weird question for me, because if my current career was not an option, it's like, are we talking about a reality where this was my career and then it fell through and then I had to go do something? Or are we talking about a reality where YouTube never happened? Because right now, the logical transition would be to, you know, be a company's, like, social media manager, or be a freelance social media or marketing consultant, or something along those lines, you know what I mean? Like, working for a company to basically do what I do now, not necessarily the videos, but I do a lot of stuff that you guys don't really see. But, like, as far as, like, you know, pipe dream, I would love to, like, I was kind of talking to one of my friends the other day. You guys know I'm, like, building a dollhouse. I would love to, like, design stuff like that for kids, like toys. Like, I'd love to design toys or design or even, like, illustrate or write books for children or work in a children's television program. Working on Sesame Street would be amazing. I know I always say I don't really like kids, but that's not entirely true. I don't like most parents, and I think that people don't think of parenting and having kids as the responsibility that I believe it is. So it leads me to feel like this kind of about, like, a lot of kid situations. But the truth is, I think that a lot of my upbringing, like, you guys know, like, my family life was kind of weird growing up, and I don't like to talk badly about people, but then I saw this quote today that was like, you know, your story is your own, and you don't have to speak nicely about someone who wasn't nice to you. You don't have to, you know, try to protect someone who treated you poorly. And, like, it kind of hit home for me. But I feel like there's other people involved, and I don't like to air dirty laundry. But you guys know, my childhood was subpar. I'm gonna cough. I'm still sick. Sorry. So I credit a lot of the goodness in me to watching, like, good TV. You know what I mean? Like, not watching, like, garbage TV, like, watching TV that was educational and, you know, taught the value of being a decent person and stuff like that. So I would love to have some participation in that, like, going for the next generation, which is kind of a weird, I would love to do things, like, that helped kids. Not necessarily work with kids, but for kids. I don't know if that makes any sense, but yeah. next question is from JS The Fens. JStiffens21. Have you ever peed your pants? Hasn't everybody peed their pants at one point or another? Like, I'm not gonna lie to you and be like, no, I've never peed my pants. Like, who pees their pants? I can't jump on a trampoline still, because, like, if I didn't pee the moment before I got on the trampoline, I will pee my pants. I'm not kidding. I'm not, like, no shame in my game. I can't jump on trampolines. They make me pee my pants. It's been like that since I was a teenager. I don't know. I feel like that wasn't an issue when I was a little kid, was an issue when I was a teenager. So, like, when people would, you know, have trampolines at their house, I was always like, no, it's dangerous. I'm not into it because I'm going to pee my pants. I'm sure it's fun as hell if you don't pee your pants on trampolines, but I do. There's some information you might not have wanted. But hey, maybe somebody out there is like, hey, I pee my pants on trampolines too, and I feel a little less bad about it. So there we go. We have that in common. Moving on. Number 7 is from Dread Sorrow, and it says, how modified is your social media due to trolls, haters, weird people, etc.? Like, do you have any keywords removed? Actually, not at all. Like, I don't use like TweetDeck or anything. I just use Twitter on my phone and on the website, or like Facebook and Instagram. If people are like off-putting to me at all, I mute them. Like, I don't block very many people. Like, you have to be like, most of the people that I block are people that don't actually follow me. That's like a thing. Like, maybe I'll tweet something that's like pseudo political or something, you know, whatever, and somebody who doesn't follow me gets wind of it and starts like harassing me. I'll block that person because they didn't follow me anyways. Like, who cares? But if someone who follows me tweets me and like makes me uncomfortable or is weird, I will usually, if they make me uncomfortable or if they're being rude or anything like that and they follow me, what I'll do is I'll block and then immediately unblock them because it forces them to unfollow me, and then I'll mute them. So like, whatever I'm doing is upsetting you so much, let me remove myself from your feed. And also, I don't want to see what the hell you have to say. If they're just kind of obnoxious, I'll just mute them. But just in general, like, I interact with people on my social media. It's not like, you know, filtered or anything like that at all. Like, I just use it like a normal person would, I guess. Or maybe a normal person would use TweetDeck. I don't know. So answer, I don't, because I'm technologically inept. Next question is from Swampers, and it says, this is a question for pretty much anyone famous on the internet. How do you stay positive with so many negative comments coming at you? Well, okay, wait, I was just talking about how I had no filters on social media. I do have filters set up on YouTube. When YouTube integrated Google+, they allowed you to make your own custom spam filters. So I have super, like, every terrible word you can imagine in my spam filter. So I don't feel like I get very many bad comments, like, to be totally honest. And I don't know if it's that my spam filter catches them, or I don't know. I just don't feel like, don't get me wrong, I've been the target of some negativity in my life. Like, obviously, like, for those of you who follow the Nostalrious Mark Kern thing, that wasn't great for me. And, you know, I did a reality show where I wasn't well received. But I don't know, all in all, I don't feel like my day-to-day experience on the internet is bad. Like, I don't feel like people go out of their way to be mean to me. And, like, don't get me wrong, I get like trolly comments and stuff like that, but most of the trolly comments are like sexual, like, just shut up and do porn. Like, it's, I don't know, it doesn't bother me. Like, for a long time it did. There was a really long time when I like really couldn't handle it, and I think maybe it comes with like age or maturity. Maybe it's something, one of those things where if you decide that this is the kind of thing you're going to be doing for a living, you have to learn to suck it up and let it go. Because if you don't, you're going to drive yourself crazy. You're going to drive yourself insane. So I don't know. I interact a lot in the comments of my videos. Like, you'll see when I post a video for the first couple hours, like, I'm pretty active responding to comments and stuff. So I think part of it is that people know that I'm actually reading and responding. And I think a lot of trolling is like looking for attention. And people know that on my channel, they don't have to do that to get attention. They'll get attention just for being nice. So I don't know. I do like to shame people. That I'll go through my spam filter and I'll see some really vile stuff. And it makes me laugh, because in the context of a spam filter, it's like, you tried and you did not succeed. It didn't even make it to where anybody could see it. But sometimes I'll go through my spam filter and I'll like screen cap it and post it on Twitter. And like, I think it's hilarious. And people think I'm mad. They're like, oh, stop feeding the trolls, blah, blah, blah. And I'm like, oh my God, stop. Can we all just laugh at this guy who spelled the C word wrong? Like, I don't know. It just doesn't bother me anymore. Like, things, so many times people have crossed lines that are so blatantly awful that I think that those experiences just put the perspective in check of like regular troll comments, and that they're not really a big deal. The next question is, what is the best tip that you would give for someone going to a psychiatrist for the first time? This is from Esmer2Dragon. I don't see a psychiatrist, I see a therapist, although the person who diagnosed me with ADHD is a psychiatrist. But I think that when you're going to something like, first of all, I think it's great. Any person, whether you feel like you have problems in life or not, like whether you're happy, sad, somewhere in the middle, I think everybody would benefit from going to a therapist. I think that therapy just really helps you get a better sense of yourself and why you feel the way you feel and why you react to things the way you do. And it's one of those things that over time, all of that perspective of how you are you helps you to preemptively stop yourself, and it helps you to, you know, start to be able to understand what your, I hate to use the word trigger, but start to understand the triggers for your stress or your anxiety or whatever are, so that you can kind of gain a more of a control on your life. And that's whether you're, like I said, even if you consider yourself to be happy, I think that you would still benefit from therapy. So let me first off say that if you're going to a psychiatrist, whether you're scared or not, you're doing an awesome thing, and you should innately feel proud of yourself. Like, regardless of how it goes and, like, how you're feeling now, like, there's no shame in being afraid of something like that. There's no, it's totally normal to be nervous, but, like, you should know deep down that you're doing something really great for yourself. And it's not just great for yourself, it's great for anybody who's going to be interacting with you. The second piece of advice I would give is that you need to know that you're going to kind of feel worse when you come out of it the first time, because the first time you go see a therapist, you're just going to dump every, you're either going to not talk, I guess, or you're going to tell them everything ever. So you're going to drudge up things that you didn't know were even bothering you. You're going to just kind of vomit out feelings. And so you might initially feel a little worse and a little chaotic, but it will get better. It's just, you got to kind of get it out in order to clean it up. So don't feel like it's not working, I guess, if after the first or second or even third time, if you don't really feel better. I think that therapy is the type of thing that it's an over time and it's about personal growth. It's not really like a quick fix. So don't be alarmed if you don't just immediately start feeling rainbows and sunshine. And the third tip that I would give you is that if you don't have a good vibe with your therapist or your counselor or your psychiatrist or whoever you're talking to, if you don't feel comfortable and you don't trust them, find someone else. Like, it, trust your gut instinct that if it's not working, it's not working. Because, like, your experience in therapy is gonna really be a lot better if you feel like you have a good relationship with the person that is your therapist. I see someone who is she does talk therapy and she also does art therapy. So what'll happen is I'll go in and I'll spend an hour or 2 hours or however long talking to her. And then a lot of times she'll kind of hit on key points that I talked about and be like, okay, well, next time you paint or next time you draw, why don't you try to, like, think about that while you're doing it and, you know, see what happens and see what comes out. And it's surprising to me, like, how well she can kind of pinpoint all of my feelings. And so I don't know. I think you need to approach it with an open mind. I think you need to not be alarmed if it doesn't work right away. And that if you don't have a good connection with your therapist, find another therapist, because it's, you'll know when you found the right person. And it, just because you haven't found the right person doesn't mean therapy isn't going to work for you. And I'm not saying it's like, I don't know, it's not a fix-all, it's not going to help every single person, but I think it would help everyone. I think everyone would benefit from talking to someone. But yeah, so those would be my pieces of advice. The next question is from Analis Gaming, and it says, from a fellow ADHD sufferer, what meds have you tried and how did they work for you? I have been on Adderall XR. I started on 10 milligrams. It did kind of nothing, so they doubled my dose to 20. It worked really well, and I was on Adderall XR daily, 20 milligrams, for about 6 months. But the combination of, I changed my birth control, and then I also, started going to yoga, and then I was on Adderall, and then all of these things, it led to me losing, like, kind of a significant amount of weight, like 15, almost 20 pounds. And I mean, granted, I probably could have stood to lose 5 or 10 of that, but the other 5 or 10 I didn't really need to lose. And I went from being like a size 3, almost 5, to being like a size 0, 1. And my doctor was a little alarmed at, not that it was that fast, because it was over the course of 6 months, closer to like 9 months by the time that, you know, I saw my doctor again. So now I'm on Adderall IR, which isn't one, the XR lasts like all day. It lasts like 12 hours. And the IR only lasts like 4 to 6 hours. And sometimes I'll take 2, which I'm prescribed 2, where I can take 1 in the morning. And then I kind of have this break where I'm hungry in the middle and I eat, and then I'll take a second one. But it kind of depends on my day, because a lot of times I don't really get going for a couple hours. And then there are times when I feel fine without it. Like, I mean, it sounds ridiculous that, like, oh, I don't need it. But, like, I definitely, there are sometimes, particularly when I'm in a high stress environment, or it's the social aspect of ADHD is what I really struggle with. Like, I had straight A's in high school. I always got my work done. Like, I have a lot of coping mechanisms that I've developed for myself over the years to deal with getting my work done when it comes to ADHD. But socially speaking, like, I interrupt people terrible when I don't take my medicine, and it's hard for me to, I lose my train of thought a lot because I'm just like in 50 places at once, and I just kind of daydream and stuff. So definitely if I'm in a social situation, I will keep myself medicated all day, I guess. But if I am just kind of home and working, I usually only take 1 a day unless it's a really long day, and then I'll take 2. Mostly because I'm the type of person that, I've never been someone who fell asleep easily. Sleep has never been it's always been a struggle since I was a little kid. Like, I had insomnia when I was like 5 or 6, like little kid. So I am very cautious about taking my, because Adderall is a stimulant, which is why it makes you lose weight. But it, it doesn't inherently make you lose weight. It just curbs your appetite. So if you're someone like me, who's, I'm a grazer, I don't sit down and eat a bulk huge meal. I have breakfast and then I have a snack before lunch and then I have lunch and then I have a snack before dinner and then I have dinner and then I have a snack and then another snack. You know what I mean? Like, I'm kind of eating all day. But when I'm on my medicine, I'm not. So, which is part of the reason I only take one a day, because then I have this period where I don't really eat much, but then I'm hungry the rest of the night, so it doesn't really matter. But where was I going with that? See, I just did it. I take one IR a day usually, sometimes two, but I try not to take them if it's late at all. Like, if it's past like 6 p.m., I won't take a second one because I don't want to have trouble falling asleep, and I don't want it to affect my sleep at all. But yeah, so I've got just as many more questions. I did 10. I'm going to do 10 more. But I do want to take a break because I got my Loot Crate DX in the mail, and I'm really excited to open it. I'm bummed because I was I was paying for Nick's subscription, and I lost my debit card, so his didn't come this month because it couldn't charge my card. But I'm super excited about this. So the first item in this month's Loot Crate DX, this was... Oh my god, I just saw what was in here and I'm so excited. So this was the build themed crate, and it had stuff from Robotech, Tetris, I feel like Fantastic Beasts, but I don't really remember, Game of Thrones. The first thing we got was this Robotech Loot Crate exclusive. This looks like he's almost like a Transformer. I think he turns from this robot guy into a fighter jet. And he is a 1 to 100 scale Veritech fighter. This is for the adult collector, not a toy. And this is very, very cool. Nick and I had to look up what Robotech was. He thought it was from Fallout. Turns out it was a show, movie, thing like that in the, maybe not 80s, but late 80s, early 90s, I think. The next thing we got is a ceramic salt and pepper set that is Tetris, and I'm really excited to see this because I love, oh my god, stop! Okay, these are the coolest salt and pepper shakers ever. So my mom used to collect salt and pepper shakers, and I kind of wish that I was still on speaking terms with her because she would get a kick out of this. But these are literally salt and pepper shakers, and they can be stacked together. Like, that's amazing. Those are amazing, and you can see they have holes in them, and they have things to fill in the bottom. These are awesome. This is one of the coolest Loot Crate things I've probably ever gotten. This is amazing. Even just for display purposes, this is amazing, but the fact that it's salt and pepper, that's pretty rad. And then the thing that I gasped about, oh my god, and that's not even everything? Good lord. The thing that I gasped about is this Game of Thrones Iron Throne Room Constructible Set. I believe this is made by McFarlane Toys. They also have the license for Walking Dead, and this is Joffrey in his throne room. It looks like it comes with a lot. It's 314 pieces, and I'm very excited to put this together. This is very, 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 very cool. This is awesome. I can't believe this came in here. I don't think this is Loot Crate exclusive, but it's still awesome that it was in here. The next thing that we got, oh my god, I think we got these socks a while ago. Like in a Loot Socks, maybe? I feel like I have these socks. Or a very similar pair of these socks. These are the, this is Hydra in Marvel, what is it, Shield, right? It's Hydra and Shield. Yeah, this was from the Versus crate. I don't know if this was a mistake or if they just sent us another pair. They're like one of my favorite pairs we've ever gotten, so I'm not mad about it. Maybe they sent me them early. I definitely have these socks, though. I'm positive I have these socks. And they're Loot Crate exclusive. I wonder where... Wait. Yeah, no, these are Loot Crate exclusive. I don't know if they were in Loot Socks, but I'm positive I have these socks. And I'm not mad about it. Let me just put that out there because these were super nice. They have like the... You probably can't see it, but they're like actual like cushy crew athletic socks, like really nice. Oh my god, there's so much in here. What is this? I just dropped a bunch of stuff. Oh, it was Fantastic Beasts. Stop it. Okay, this is a model set. This is a book. And can you tell me more? This is a book and model set. Oh, it's like an art book. Okay, you guys know how I love this kind of stuff. So this is like a little art book from Fantastic Beasts, which I can't turn pages, apparently. Oh, a Niffler! You guys know I love Nifflers. They're my favorite. And then it also came with a construction kit to make the Swooping Evil, which... Was this like the... the Discord, like, black blob, or was this something else? I don't really remember. This is cool, though. I'm definitely going to put this together, too. What a cool crate. And then the pin this month was a Megazord. And it's a Power Rangers Megazord. Oh, you know what? The regular Loot Crate had a Megazord pin as well, but it was colored and it was smaller. So what's this say? Thanks to support, blah, blah, blah. New logo. Okay. Build. Oh, bonus loot wear socks. Build your wardrobe with these stylish socks. Oh, yeah. So the socks were a bonus item. I knew I had them because they're from Loot Wear. They were just like, hey, we have a thing. It's Loot Wear. This is awesome. So, yeah, this was a really good, really, really good crate. Also, they do a mega crate for every single different crate. And this month's mega crate had the Batman Arkham Knight Limited Edition PlayStation 4 console, the Power Rangers Legacy Thunder Megazord action figure, the TactBit 28-piece USB-powered LED lamp set. That's a Tetris lamp. Do you see it? As well as a 55-inch LG 4K Ultra HD Smart TV and the LEGO Dimensions pack for starter pack for PlayStation 4. So awesome Loot Crate DX this month. Super, super good. I'm very, very excited with everything I got. My favorite thing is probably, I don't know, the construction set. The Game of Thrones construction set is awesome, but like truthfully, these salt and pepper shakers are super rad as well. And I'm not mad about getting the bonus socks. Like I said, these were one of my favorite pairs of socks ever. Plus, if I wanted to now, I could have two matching ones because they come with two different ones that you wear together. But now I technically have two of each. So, I mean, I could do... Well, I guess not. They would be upside down. Anywho, let's get back to our regularly scheduled Q&A. If you guys are interested in getting your own Loot Crate, whether it's Loot Crate DX, Core Loot Crate, Loot Pets, Loot Gaming, just so you know, this month coming up, both Loot Crate and Loot Gaming are going to have Overwatch items in them. So if you're interested in getting that, the Loot Gaming and Core Loot Crate, regular Loot Crate, both have Overwatch items, lootcrate.com/tradechat. Use code tradechat to get 10% off your first purchase. And thank you so much to Loot Crate for making this video ad-free. We really appreciate it. So the next question is from Hunter Reese 1, and it says, what are your top 5? Oh, most of the questions, I think, from here on out are gaming related. I think I split them up so that the first 10 were personal and the last 10 are gaming related. So what are your top 5 favorite wild vanity pets? This is a hard question for me because I tend to like pets that people don't care about. Like, one of my favorite pets in the entire world is the Baron's giraffe calf or whatever. I love that pet. I also like the cheetah cub that you can get from the Barons that you have to, like, it's rare and you have to find it. I really, really like the gooey Shaoling. Mine's name is the Shaw of Derp. And I like the de-weaponized mechanical companion. It's like a little robotic bunny with like a light bulb as its butt. And I love Mischief. I like a lot of pets though. 5 isn't enough. I have like hundreds and hundreds. I think I'm at 824. Does that sound crazy? Well, does it sound possible? I feel like 824 is where I'm at right now. So 5 is just a really tough number for me to narrow it down to. The next question is from Missy Moo Moo X, and it says, if you could be any character from WoW, who would you be and why? Like, this is a hard question for me too, because I assume that you mean like lore character, and like, I don't really want to be any of the lore characters. They're all a mess. Like, they all have had, like, horrible tragedies happen to them. Can I just be my character? Can I just be my shaman? I love her. My shaman is a, she's Restospec, and she is a Pandaren, and she's really cute, and she has great transmog and a lot of mounts and a lot of pets. And I feel like she's just kind of, like, the derpy sidekick peacekeeper of Azeroth. I would like to be my own character. That would be great. The next question is from Goltech, and it says, if WoW made a free-to-play option up to max level with limits on activities, would it be a detriment or a good thing? I think it'd be horrible. I know a lot of people want WoW to go free-to-play. I think it would be awful. All free-to-play games exist in a universe where there are microtransactions that are game-changing. Very few free-to-play games are truly free-to-play in a way that you don't at some point have to spend some money. So I feel like it would just be opening the door to a pay-to-win scenario. I also feel like keeping a price tag on WoW keeps the community kind of at bay because, I mean, you can go to like MMO Champ or whatever and you see so many people on there and they're just complaining and griping. They're like, I don't even play WoW anymore. Everything's stupid, blah, blah, blah. And I just can't imagine if it was free to play and those people were actually like in-game part of the community. I feel like so much of the negativity in the WoW community aren't even people who play. So I don't know. I think that in order for them to keep up you know, a lot of content and a lot of updates and just all of the support that we get now, I think it would be almost impossible to do on free-to-play. And I think free-to-play would bring in a really shitty community, and I think that it would likely end up being, like, if not pay to win, very close to pay to win, which I want no part of. So I think it would be a detriment. The next question is from Hawkeye Lifer, and it says, haven't played WoW since Wrath of the Lich King because kids. So question, would it be hard for an old gamer to get back into WoW? Now, not at all. I always tell people, if you played in Wrath of the Lich King, if you played in Burning Crusade, you would really like Legion. And Legion lets you start out with a level 100 if you want to, so you can go in and kind of get right into the content. It's non-linear, so you can choose where you want to go. You can do what you want to do. If you end up in the wrong place, it doesn't matter. Everything scales to you anyways. I think that there's just a lot of awesome stuff in WoW right now, and I think there's a lot of stuff that is really cool for casual players too. I think that there's such a good balance right now of stuff for PvPers, stuff for hardcore PvEers, stuff for people who are playing that end game content, stuff for people who are playing by themselves, more casual guilds that want to do types of things. There's just so much to do that I think that it wouldn't be hard. I think you would enjoy yourself a lot, and I think you should give it a try if that's what you want to do. The next question is from Sinister8794, and it says, what is your guess on the next WoW expansion? Well, I think at this point, it's like kind of unfair to be like, well, my guess is, because we know that at the end of this expansion, we're going to Argus. So it's pretty clear that we're going to be spending a lot of time in Argus next expansion, unless something happens. I guess, to be fair, we haven't seen what happens when we go to Argus in 7.3, but I assume that we're not going to be done with whatever our, I don't know if it'll be like the, you know, the Burning Legion in particular, but I wouldn't be surprised if we were fighting Old Gods next expansion. I wouldn't be surprised if we were finding out what that weird spot under Tearsfield Glades is. I feel like we're going to see a lot of old meaty lore being brought back up next expansion. I would also love to see a new playable race, because we haven't gotten one since Pandaren's, and I think that after this expansion, I would love to see, like, the Suramar, like, the Highborn and the Nightborn. Maybe they could become a neutral playable race, since they're not really Horde or Alliance, or, even like the High Mountain Torrent. I would love to see those offshoots of different, I mean, I guess that's not really a, that's just what I want. That's not really a prediction, but I don't know. I long time ago, I was like, they won't put pandas in WoW, and if they do, I'm quitting WoW, and then they did, so I don't make predictions anymore, and when I do, they're very vague, I guess, and I'm happy to be wrong. Like, I'm not a game designer, and I'm not a theory crafter, and I am in no position to be like, I know what it is, and it's this thing. Like, I worry about when I'm the smartest person in the room. Like, I'm not a dumb person by any means, but there's a lot of people a lot more knowledgeable than me on just about everything in the entire world. So if I'm in a situation where I'm genuinely the most knowledgeable and smartest person in the room, like, I want to be in a different room. So please don't look to me for that, because I don't know. The next question is from Pretty Potato Cup, and it says, what Overwatch character would be easier for someone who's not into the shootery type games? Definitely try out Mercy. She's a lot of fun. I also think that someone like Torbjorn or Bastion would probably be good for you. Any of the healers would be great. There's a video, if you go to Overking's YouTube channel, there's a video that's like the top 10 heroes that you don't have to aim. And it's true. There's a lot of heroes that you can play. Junkrat is another one. You can have garbage aim and be an awesome Junkrat. So look for people that don't have, like, definitely stay away from Hanzo. Stay away from Widowmaker. I would even stay away from 76. To be good at 76, you have to be able to aim well. So I assume if you're not into shootery stuff that you would be, I would try, Mercy would be my number one. You should try Mercy. Lucio would be another, Lucio would be another good one. Yeah, any of the healers, anybody who doesn't require a lot of aim. Winston would be fun too. And D.Va. I don't know. Just play Overwatch. It's a fun game. It's just a fun game. The next question is from Blue Gamer Brothers, and it says, do you think Doomfist will be in Overwatch this year? unpopular opinion, I don't think Doomfist is ever going to be a hero in Overwatch. And I'm going to go even further and say, I hope he's not a hero in Overwatch, because Doomfist, number one, is not a singular person. It's not. Doomfist is a title, and Doomfist can change, and it has changed. So putting Doomfist in the roster really limits the lore, in my opinion, because they have to have that person remain Doomfist for the entirety of the game, or else it would be a detriment to the lore. So I really genuinely hope that Doomfist is not a hero, and I don't think he's going to be a hero. I think that we'll find out more about him. I think if Doomfist is in the game at all, it'll be in a Juggernaut-style game where one person is Doomfist and then, like, he's fighting six people, because Doomfist could level skyscrapers. He was, like, crazy strong and crazy powerful, much more powerful than any of our heroes are now. And in order to do him any justice to his lore, they can't have him be toe-to-toe with other heroes. It just wouldn't be fair. I don't know. I hope he's not a hero. And I think also with the Effie thing, I almost made a video on this, and I just was like, I don't know, man. I don't want to put all this effort into doing all this research and, like, scripting this video and doing this whole complicated thing for, like, four people to see it. But I think that people are on the wrong track with Effie as well. I don't think Effie is making the new hero. A lot of people think that. A lot of people are like, oh, Effie's making the new hero and blah, blah, blah. I think that Effie is going to, I think whoever is Effie's nemesis, I guess, whoever grounded, because Effie was supposed to be taking a flight. Let me just back up a second. If you have no idea what I'm talking about, Google Effie, E-F-I, Overwatch, and you'll find out all of these little leaks that they've been doing. She is definitely part of whatever the next hero is going to be, but she's not the next hero because she's 11 years old. And I genuinely don't think she's building the next hero, because if you look at what she's building, in my opinion, it seems a lot like she's building like a Lucio bot. Like, that's what it looks like to me. Like, she's building her own personal Lucio bot, which is creepy, but cool simultaneously. I don't think she's making the new hero. I don't think that that's a, we know Bastion isn't, he's like kind of sentient. He's kind of sentient. And we know Zenyatta is full on sentient, but like we don't fully understand at this point in the lore, like, how a machine goes from being built to being conscious. And I don't think that an 11-year-old is going to be where we learn that type of information. I think that she is going to make something that discovers the new hero, whether it be, you know, there was some sort of attack at the airport and nobody was hurt, but she was there and it grounded her plane so she couldn't go where she was going. And I think that whoever was responsible for grounding that plane, and I guess Doomfist is missing now, although I also don't think that has anything, I think that's unrelated, right? Like, I don't think it was the same person who chucked that bot up against the wall or exploded that bot up against the wall, whatever. I don't think that was the same thing as whoever took Doomfist. I don't know if they're working together. I don't know. But I feel like, I don't know how Doomfist works. And I think this could be coming from a place of ignorance. And if you guys know more about it, I would love to hear. But is it like the Sword in the Stone where not anybody can just use it? Or is it like so powerful that anybody can use it and it's just this all-powerful weapon, right? Like, is it something that so it's like, I don't know if it would even function if it was in the hands of someone who couldn't, I don't know. I feel like it's more complicated than that. And I kind of feel like, what if someone was there to attack Effie, so someone else was like, oh, in case of emergency, break glass, stole Doomfist to punch whoever, you know, was trying to attack Effie, which led to this confrontation in the airport where the OR-15s were damaged, but it wasn't the villain who had Doomfist, it was somebody trying to help. And I don't think that that person trying to help would necessarily be like, here's a new hero, and they're Doomfist. I think that, I just think it's going to be more complex than that. I don't, just based on everything Blizzard has done so far about, you know, Sombra and, I'm going to yawn, excuse me, Anna Amari, and the way that all that has gone down, I just don't think that all of a sudden they're just going to be like, okay, Doomfist is in the game. I don't know what I think, but I don't think Doomfist is going to be a hero, and I'm going to be disappointed if he is. Because again, Doomfist is like this mantle that's passed from one person to the other, and also, like, do we have a Doomfist currently? Because I know the weapon was on display in the museum, and Talon was trying to steal it, but, like, what happened to our most recent Doomfist? Did he die? Did he die, though? Like, I don't know. That's clearly, this is a long-winded topic for me. The next question is from Skytarian, and it says, have you ever thought about doing 39 things about other Blizzard games like Diablo, Overwatch, or StarCraft? I actually did do, I think it was only 29 things, or 19 things. I did do one for Overwatch. Maybe I'll do another one in the future. That's a good idea. I mean, it's one of those things where I don't think it's a bad idea. I think it's just about finding, I did League, too. But I think it's just about finding the right timing of everything. Like, a good time to do a Diablo one would be, like, before a new season or something. So, yeah, maybe I'll do something like that in the near future. That would be fun. The next question is from Cockle Ivanov, and it says, have you ever played Warcraft 3? No, but Nick has played all the Warcrafts. I know that doesn't count. I love to do that. No, I haven't done that, but Nick did it. I just feel like we're married, so our experiences are shared. I have not played Warcraft 3, but I'm familiar with Warcraft 3. My older brother played it, and Nick played it, and a bunch of my friends have played it. I just never played it. And the very last question is from J. Davis 1132, and it says, I've always wondered, where did you get those awesome Warglaives? And I think he's talking about the ones on the wall. And I feel like this is the most underwhelming answer ever, but they were on Amazon for like $18. They're just like kids' toys. They're not, they're just plastic. They're not heavy or whatever. They look really nice, but they were like $20 on Amazon. All the weapons on my wall were really cheap on Amazon. So yeah, that's all the things. Thank you so much again. I was going to show the box, but it's gone now. Thank you so much again to Loot Crate DX for making this video ad-free. This was all the wonderful stuff that was in this month's Loot Crate DX. Just as a reminder, next month's Loot Gaming, as well as the core Loot Crate, will include an Overwatch item. So if you're interested in that, head over to lootcrate.com/tradechat. Use discount code tradechat to get a discount, because that's how discount codes work. Also, if you're interested in me doing another Q&A video, let me know. Maybe I'll do another one in the future. It's been a long time. So, it's been a long time. I am going to go. I hope you guys are all having a wonderful day. I love you all so much. You're in my hearts. I'll see you soon. Goodbye. Goodbye.